tell you a little bit about Physicians for National Health Program. As an organization, we started back in 1987, and we serve as really the educational arm of this movement. Many of the PNHP doctors do research, which is published in peer-reviewed journals, that on what the current health situation is in this country, the number of people that are dying of excess deaths, going bankrupt, you know, the costs that are being spent, all these various things. PNHP does research and updates that. We also train physicians and non-physicians. You don't have to be a physician to join PNHP. Train you how to go out to your community and educate. And we have speakers. If you have a community group, we're willing to come out to your group and speak and educate about single payer. So that's PNHP. We have chapters in most of the states, and there is a chapter here in Maryland. So we invite you to sign up if you're not already a member and join us in our activities. I wanted to talk a little bit about what's happening at the national scene, and actually, it seems kind of noisy in here, huh? Can you guys hear okay? Okay. The national legislation that PNHP advocates for is called HR 676. It was just reintroduced as of Friday of last week for this Congress, so it will be in play now for the next 2 years. The title is the Expanded and Improved Medicare for All Act. And at the onset, as of this afternoon actually, we have 27 co-sponsors for this piece of legislation. None of our Maryland congressional members are on this bill yet. In the past, Congressman Cummings and Congresswoman Edwards have been co-sponsors. So if you can, this is the time to contact your members of Congress and ask them to get on HR 676. It's a very simple bill to read, so if you have a chance, you know, it's not that many pages, I encourage you to go to the website, either our Maryland website, md.pnhp.org, and that's available in the back. You can read it there, or you can read it through our Maryland single payer, mdsinglepayer.org website. So why are we reintroducing HR 676 when we just passed healthcare reform, right? Well, we recognize that the bill that passed fails to address the fundamental problems that we have in this country, and so it's going to leave still tens of millions of people without any coverage at all, and it's not going to control our healthcare costs. Actually, shortly after the bill was passed, the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services did a study looking at our total healthcare costs as a country, estimated they would rise 1% faster than they would have if we had done nothing under this new legislation. We are concerned that more and more people are going to be forced to purchase insurance products that are inadequate to meet their needs, so that they're still at risk of bankruptcy should they have a serious illness or accident. They will continue to face financial barriers to care, so putting off necessary medical care because people don't have the money to pay their deductible to get the medications they need or the tests that they need. So we haven't solved the problem yet, so we need to keep pushing for it. We anticipate that within the next 5 years, healthcare is going to come back on the national scene. And so we need to be ready for when that happens. By being educated and by being organized, we can make this happen. And how do I know that? Well, the proof is standing in the back of the room. Sandra and Bekah, who will speak to us later, have made single payer politically feasible in the state of Vermont, and they're going to share with you how they did that. So I also wanted to share a little bit, or was asked to share a little bit about what's currently happening in this Congress, because as you know, the legislation that was passed last year, the health bill, was passed by a Democratic majority Congress. We now have a Republican majority in the House of Representatives, and they have pledged to repeal the law, which they did try to do. They passed it, a repeal of it, but of course it's not going to go, it didn't pass in the Senate, so that's not going to happen. But what it looks like is happening is that there's going to be a consistent attack on the legislation to defund it and block its implementation. In addition to that, it's already happening. It's already falling apart. businesses and insurance companies have been applying to our Department of Health and Human Services for waivers to excuse them from being able, from having to comply with provisions of the bill. So hundreds of these waivers have already been issued. The Department of Health and Human Services now has a 24-hour turnaround time on issuing waivers, excusing people from complying with the legislation. It's a complicated piece of legislation, unfortunately, and that's, you know, that's going to be what happens. There's a simple solution. The simple solution is a national expanded and improved Medicare for all. It's simple. It's everybody in, nobody out. There's also a lot of energy at the state level. There are more than 20 states now that are pushing at that level to pass single-payer systems, hoping that perhaps we can follow Canada's example where they passed it in one province and then it gradually spread and then it became a national system. That's not going to happen on its own. If we pass it in one state, it's not automatically going to become national. So we have to keep our eye on what the goal is and keep organizing to push for that goal. We want everybody in this country to have access to high-quality healthcare.